Former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie has written a new book. Perhaps you've seen him on television. I got a chance to interview him this morning. We talked for 10 minutes about his relationship with President Trump, why he was fired by the transition team, and who fired him, which is rather interesting, where he sees President Trump now compared to what he saw a couple of years ago when he was the first one to endorse him, where the Republican Party goes, and his thoughts on Larry Hogan and if Larry Hogan could beat Donald Trump in a primary and if he would like for that to happen. So here's my conversation with former Governor Chris Christie this morning on WBAL. Good morning. It's Bryan Nehman here with you on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5. We are pleased to be joined by Governor Chris Christie, who has a new book out entitled Let Me Finish, Trump, the Kushners, Bannon, New Jersey, and the Power of In-Your-Face Politics. Great to have you on. Really appreciate you coming on the show.
Bryan, happy to be here.
A lot of stuff to talk about, but I've always wanted to ask you this question. You were one of the first of the in-your-face, not-going-to-apologize kind of politicians. Tell it like it is. I remember the videos of you going back and forth with constituents. Nobody did that, right? And conservative radio loved you. You had the Tea Party that loved you, embraced you. And now they look at you as a squish or a rhino or establishment. What happened? Did you change? Did the party change? What's going on there?
I'm still the same guy I've been all my life here in New Jersey, and we write about that in the book, about how all this developed and why I am that person I am, and I've never changed a bit. Listen, people's opinions in the political commentary world change like the wind blows.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can't allow yourself to be judged that way. The way I've always been judged is the people who are my friends, the people who know me the best. Am I the same person I've always been? And I am. This is who I am. It's authentic. It's who I've always been. And I don't think I'll ever be changing. And so their opinions may change, but who I am has never changed.
Well, whose soul is closer to the soul of the party? Where is it right now?
It's President Trump's party. He's the leader of the party. He's the leader of the country. And when in our system of government, when you have a president who's from your party, he runs the party. So it is President Trump's party. I'm proud and happy to have supported him. Most of what he's done, I agree with. Some things I disagree with. And I detail all of that in the book. But in the end, I think you look at who this party is right now. And while there is some difference of opinion, the overwhelming majority of our party believes in President Trump.
Yeah, his approval rating is still very, very high within the Republican Party. You were one of the first to endorse him. What did you see then, and what do you see now with Donald Trump, the now president of the United States?
Well, here's what I saw at the time. I saw a guy who had come in just a whisker behind Ted Cruz in Iowa, had won New Hampshire 2-1 in a crowded field, and then won South Carolina by double digits. Anybody else who had done that in our party would be called the nominee. Once he did that, and I've been friends with him for 17 years, it was time for my wife and I to decide, did we want to be involved in the race at all? And if we did, would we be supporting our friend, Donald Trump? And we decided to do that. And what I saw of him as a candidate was someone who was very instinctive, very effective, and very persuasive. Now, Donald Trump as president has done a lot of good things on taxes, on regulation, on judges, but he also has made some really bad personnel choices, which I think have impacted his administration negatively and have held the country back a bit. And I'm hoping that in the second 2 years, he's learned from that and will make better personnel choices.
We're talking with Chris Christie. His new book out is entitled Let Me Finish, Trump, the Kushners, Bannon, New Jersey, and the Power of In-Your-Face Politics. You are not in the administration. You were part of the transition team. You were essentially fired.
I was fired.
You were fired. So
yeah.
Why? What happened? Was it Donald Trump or was it somebody related to Donald Trump?
Well, when folks read the first chapter in the book, which is called Bannon Blinks, that details me being called into Steve Bannon's office 2 days after the election and being fired. And it's a very contentious chapter, a very contentious argument between me and Steve Bannon. And in the end, I demanded to know who had initiated the firing so I could go and talk to that person. He wouldn't tell me for the longest time. And then finally, he said to me, listen, it was the kid. And the kid in the campaign, when they referred to that way, was nobody else other than Jared Kushner. And so Steve told me that it was Jared's idea. And one of the quotes I put in the book that Steve said to me was, he said, he's been taking an axe to your head with the boss ever since I got here.
Hmm.
And so I think that's what happened. And I suffered that penalty because I did my job as U.S. attorney.
I was going to say, is that retribution because you went after his father?
You'll see there's a chapter in the book called Jared's Meltdown, where the day that Donald Trump was offering me the transition chairmanship of the campaign, Jared came into the meeting, interrupted the meeting uninvited, and made an argument right in front of me as to why I shouldn't be transition chairman because of my prosecution of his father. At that time, Donald Trump stood up and said Chris was just doing his job. You can't criticize him for doing his job. That's not right, and I'm giving him the job. But that obviously changed over the course of time.
You know, what's been going on lately, the indictment of Roger Stone, a lot of people on the right will say that these are process crimes, that they're just getting them for perjury or the cover-up. Are these process crimes? You're a former federal prosecutor. What do you see?
Well, listen, they're crimes. And you can call them process crimes if you want, but and they're certainly not related to Russian collusion. And so in that respect, everyone's right. They're not related to Russian collusion. But if you're a prosecutor and you're investigating Russian collusion and you either stumble over other crimes, as they did with Paul Manafort and what he was up to in Ukraine and with banks in the United States and around the world, or if you're lied to as a prosecutor while investigating Russian collusion, you have an obligation to bring all those charges. And if you don't have the jurisdiction to do it, you do like what they did with Michael Cohen, which was when they came across the evidence, they sent it to the jurisdiction that could prosecute him. I don't think it reflects on anything regarding Russian collusion, but there are crimes that were committed, and prosecutors have the ethical obligation to investigate and indict criminal conduct. And that's what we do, and we wouldn't want anything different in this country.
We're talking with former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie. His book is entitled Let Me Finish. Donald Trump is known as the negotiator, right? The art of the deal. As a politician or as a president, is he a good negotiator?
Well, he's been good. He negotiated a great new trade deal for us with Mexico and Canada, and that certainly was not easy, and I think took a lot of skill. He was able to negotiate a tax cut plan. He was able to negotiate through putting over 100 judges now on the federal bench and working with the United States Senate on that, including two Supreme Court justices. This past week was not a great week. You know, when the government gets closed down for 35 days and, you know, the president has to essentially give everybody a three-week timeout to sit there and try to determine whether or not they're going to actually be willing to make a deal with each other. That's a never a good thing for the president. And I think on this one, in interacting with Congress in this way, he hasn't had a lot of experience doing it and doesn't have a lot of experienced people around him who he's listening to. And I think that was a mistake and led to some of the results that we got in the past 4 weeks with the government shutdown.
Could Donald Trump be primaried?
I don't believe so. I think Donald Trump is as popular in the Republican Party as anybody I've ever seen. And I think that he is really, it would be incredibly unlikely for him to be challenged or challenged successfully.
So that means you're not going to run in 2020.
Oh, no, not at all. You know, some recent comments I made were misinterpreted. I mean, I got asked out in California a week or so ago, would I ever run for president again? Well, ever is a long time, and I'm only 56, and I hope I'm part of the ever for a long time. And so you would never say never to that, but no, I don't have any expectation of primarying the president.
If I could quickly, Larry Hogan is the governor of our state here in Maryland.
Love Larry Hogan. Why? He's the man.
All right, so why has he been so successful, and is there a place in him in national politics in the Republican Party?
Listen, Larry Hogan is popular because he's honest, authentic, and effective. He works with the other side of the aisle. He gets things done. That's what the American people want more than anything else, and Larry is just incredibly effective and incredibly good at that. And so, you know, I think that Larry has whatever future he wants in politics. I think he's got a limitless future in politics. And the fact is that he deserves it because he's earned it.
But
he's earned it by hard work.
Could he ever win or win over, you know, the base of the Trump supporters that they're out there now?
Really, really hard to tell, Brian. Mm-hmm. And I don't know that that's where Larry, I've seen all the recent speculation, but I talk to Larry rather regularly, and I just don't believe that's where Larry's headed with his career. I think he's completely focused on Maryland and wanting to use his final 4 years as governor in a way that cements some of the gains that have been made by the Hogan administration. And God, I hope he does that, because he's really done things to transform Maryland and done it in cooperation with the Democrats. I did that in New Jersey for 8 years. I had a Democratic legislature my entire 8 years, and it's not easy to do, believe me. And you're seeing in Washington how hard it is to deal with divided government. Mm-hmm. Larry Hogan and I have dealt with it for our entire careers, but if you're willing to really compromise, if you're willing to work with the other side and listen to them, you can get things done. And I'm a example of that in Jersey, and you could bet Larry Hogan is an example of that in Maryland.
The book is entitled Let Me Finish, Trump, the Kushners, Bannon, New Jersey, and the Power of In-Your-Face Politics. Governor Chris Christie, pleasure to have you on. Best of luck with the book.
Bryan, thanks so much for the time to talk to all your listeners, and I appreciate it. And let all the Marylanders know they're lucky to have Larry Hogan for another 4 years.